Okay, let's first go into the two species that we see, and we'll go into that in greater depth a little bit later in terms of the differences between the two. So we see the white rhino, so the square-lipped rhino, and then we get the hook-lipped or the black rhino, much rarer to see out here, but we do get them. The last time I saw one, it was hanging upside down from a helicopter during one of our TV shows as it was being transported somewhere else to safety. I don't know exactly what was happening, but it was a truly, truly bizarre moment, wasn't it, Brian? Mm. It really was. We were all of us sort of saw it at different times. Steph was on walk, we were sitting with Sindile, and glanced up, and VM zoomed right in, and there was this black rhino hanging upside down. Live black rhino, that's how they often transport them when they're rushing to do something like that. Right, so gestation period is just under about a year and a half. So you're looking at between 15 or 16 months for both species. A white rhino is sometimes a little bit shorter. Again, much like all of our mammals, that's a rough estimate. Oh, my drawings fell down. It's all right. We'll get back to that later. So you're looking at a sort of a roughly just under a year and a half. Once the calf is born for both black rhino and white rhino, it then stays with its mother for roughly a year and a half or so. And around about that point, the female comes back into estrus. A shrimp monster, you were wondering about how long the calves will stay with their mums. It's a very complicated time in a little rhino calf's life. They form very tight bonds with their mothers. And for the first few weeks of their life, mom keeps every other rhino away. Then she gets more social and she accepts other rhinos back to, and they form their little group, which is called a crash of rhinos. There you go. So they'll form their little group. There you go, Laurie. We're just smashing out these questions now. Laurie, there you go. A group of rhino is a crash. It's also sort of a herd, but it's the proper collective noun is a crash. Once the female comes back into estrus, that's when it gets really complicated for the little calf, because all of a sudden a male rhino arrives on the scene, doesn't particularly appreciate the presence of the calf, particularly young male calves, and will chase them away regularly from their mom. And of course, all they want to do is come back to their mom, and they get very confused and look very lost and spend a lot of time making the most amazing sounds. Rhino make the best sounds in the world. They sound like dolphins or whales. They sort of... It's amazing to watch. Anyway, that was a terrible impression of a rhino. Absolutely appalling. Once the female then gives birth, she will then kick out her other calf, which is deeply traumatic, and will only let it rejoin once that little calf has grown up a little bit. Let's go and find out what Tristan's found. It sounds fascinating. I got distracted. I thought Rebecca said that the buffalo was stuck in the mud. So that's why I was totally distracted. I should have properly finished clarifying. The female comes into estrus. The female rhino comes into estrus at about a year, and when the calf is about a year and a half old, she's then pregnant with the next one for another year and a half. So a rhino calf will stay with its mother for 3 years. It is dependent upon its mother for 3 years before its sibling is born and it's booted out for a while. Then, after a few weeks, she'll actually let her calf come back, and she may even, if it's a female, she may end up hanging out with it for the rest of that calf's life. Maybe, probably not all the way, but around there. And they do live for about 40 years, so they do live for quite a long time. So there you go. Bethany was wondering about whether they gather in breeding groups, bachelor groups. So the structure, it's a funny thing. There was always this fallacy that black rhino, and we'll get into the differences in a moment. I've drawn up a whole table of differences. There's always this fallacy that black rhino are incredibly antisocial and solitary, whereas white rhino are not. The more we see, the more we know about their behavior and the fact that they actually have a very similar structure to white rhino. They might not be as gregarious, but they certainly spend a lot of time together in groups. The important thing to remember is that rhinos don't have a set structure. It changes depending on the situation and what's going on around them. What you'll often find is a series of, or a pair of females, or even more, together with their offspring. And that can be the current offspring and the previous generation gathered together. So I've seen crashes of up to 6-7 rhino gathered together. Then you get the territorial bulls, and they become territorial at around about 8 years old. They start to mark their territory, show signs of dominance, fighting other males for territorial rights and females. They have a territory that encompasses that of the females. The females don't really have a territory. They have a home range. They move about. They don't have a particular, they don't mark their territories at all. They defecate in middens, but that's like rhino Facebook. It's their way of communicating with each other. It's not a territorial marking, whereas for the males, it is. So the males will have a territory. They will allow sub-adult males within their territory, even if they're not related to them. It doesn't bother them, provided they are showing no sign of dominance. As soon as they start to urine spray or urine scent mark scrape, then they will actually start to push them out, and they'll have to go and establish their own territory. They often hang out with the females, and what you'll often find is you do get bachelor groups, but usually it's just male offspring that are being booted out from their mum and have joined together because they actually just feel comfortable being in a group. They get scared on their own, like elephants in a way. All right, so just quickly, white rhinoceros. Obviously, the story about a white rhinoceros getting its name, supposedly from the Dutch word wide, wit, wide-mouthed rhinoceros. So that actually, once you remember that, it pretty much explains almost everything here. So they're larger. They are close to and over 2 tons in the case of a big rhino bull. I once went on a rhino darting to transfer him away from a place where he was at high risk of being poached. And you walk them. Once they're sort of semi-sedated, you walk them blindfolded into the crate to move them away. And I'm 5'7", and I was helping him, pushing up against his shoulder with my great strength to guide him. And he was about this tall at the shoulder. So they're a lot bigger than they can get a lot bigger than you think they can. They're absolutely massive. So up to 2 tons, whereas the black rhino doesn't really get over around about 1.3, maybe 1.4. In really exceptional cases. I've met one once who was 1.4. His name is Fakita, and he's angry. He was a very, very angry black rhino. Not all of them are, but he was a particularly angry black rhino. So because they're grazers, white rhino hold their heads down most of the time. Obviously, they're lifted up if they're looking at something, but most of the time, their natural position is down. Speaking from experience, that head is heavy. So as a result, they've got quite well-developed shoulders and quite a large hump, almost a hunchback on their shoulders, whereas black rhino don't really have that. They've got a slightly more agile shape and a slightly more curved back. Square-lipped, because they eat grass. It makes sense for cropping, same as a hippopotamus, just cropping the grass. Hook-lipped, because black rhino are browsers. They chew on twigs and leaves and trees and so on. That means their dung looks completely different, it smells completely different. Very characteristically, they bite at a 45-degree angle. So when you find a plant that's been fed on by a black rhino, it's got perfect 45-degree angles on the little branches. The white rhino's ears slightly more elongated, the black rhino's slightly rounder, but now we're getting into real semantics. And then, the funny one, I always love this, the calf runs behind in a black rhino and in front in the white rhino. And when I was a small child, the thing that really inspired me to love the bush was rhino. I always thought it was because black rhinos were stricter mums, that they were more strict with their calves and therefore they were forced to run behind their mothers and not in front. It's because it's to do with their habitat. So it's to do with the fact that the black rhino will run through thick vegetation, so the calf has to follow mum, whereas the white rhino will run through open spaces, which will allow it to be directed, can run ahead. Mum can put herself between the threat and her baby and guide it with her horn. James, you want to know how white rhino and black rhino tracks differ. A black rhino track is a large male is still smaller than that of a cow. A white rhino cow. So there's a distinctive difference to the size of them. I'm gonna try and draw one for you. Oh, just quickly before, because these diagrams need explaining. This is the profile of a white rhino. Their secondary horn is quite short. In black rhino, that often grows, the secondary horn often grows to almost the same size as the primary horn. Okay, quickly tracks. Let me try and do this. You know what I'm like with artistry. So a track. These are quite elongated, and you've got quite a distinct back pad. So that's white rhino, 3 toes, 1, 2, 3. These are side toes are quite large. A black rhino is much, oh goodness. Ah, the wind's blowing. No, stay still. Black rhino. The side toes are slightly smaller. That is a bit, that was not the best drawing I've ever done, but the side toes are smaller and slightly further away from the main toe. That wasn't the best drawing I've ever done. I've got exciting news for you though, from an animal we can't show to an animal we all love. Let's go and see how Tristan's doing. I know discussion, but before we go on to that, I just wanted to say I've seen leopards stalking, not stalking to kill, to hunt and kill, but stalking for fun. I've seen them stalk rhino before. And there's often sightings you don't realize, because obviously we've got quite good, and our camera operators are quite good at hiding rhino from you. But we have had many, many sightings with leopard and rhino combined, haven't we, Brian?
Yeah.
You must have had a few. And you see the poor camera operators trying to duck and dive. I had one particular wild dog sighting where they started chasing three rhino, and there was nothing we could do. We couldn't explain to final control that there were rhino in the site. Eventually we did. I think James eventually did, just because it was starting to go. It was turning into a farce. The two of us switching between vehicles, trying to explain why we were not with the dogs when it was... I think my particular highlight was when I said, oh, they're going into a place where we probably can't off-road to follow them, and two vehicles went vroom around me and after them. You just sit there going, oh no, oh dear. Sometimes they photobomb us as well. They just pop out of nowhere. Or you drive around the corner and all of a sudden there's a rhino there. I'm driving through an undisclosed location. We'd been talking, we were looking for lions. We'd been talking about vultures, I think. And there was a rhino in the road. As I came up the dip, there was just this bottom straight in front of me. And I went, oh, look at the vultures that aren't there but could be there. The camera's swinging wildly. So we've had some very entertaining times avoiding rhino, which is sad, but at the same time, we have to laugh at it because it just, it is what it is. I've got a special treat for you. I'm going to try, I can't do the rhino sound very well, so I'm going to play it for you. And I'll have to do this in the sort of really basic way by putting my phone up to my microphone. So sorry about this. But here you go. This is what... Cute. I love this sound. So this is a calf begging sound, but this is what they sound like regularly. Sounds like a whale or a dolphin or something like that, doesn't it? Fascinating sound. Yes, cuties, you're so sweet. Now, Michael, you want to know if our two species will ever interbreed. Michael, no, they don't. They're actually very far removed, our white rhino and our black rhino. They suspect, just through studying their DNA and through various biological research that's happened with the various rhino species, they suspect that the black rhino, as we know it, is probably one of the newest rhino species that we get out here, whereas the white rhino is probably one of the oldest. So whilst they look quite similar, they've both got two horns as opposed to something like the greater one-horned or the Indian rhino that is in Asia. They suspect that they're very, very separate and distinct species, and so much so that their Latin names are completely separate. They don't even share a genus in terms of their level of connectedness. So something like a lion or a leopard would have the same genus. They are part of the Panthera family. Rhino, completely separate. So our black rhino and our white rhino. Interestingly enough, there's a lot of argument about the subspecies of the black rhino. There's a lot of different subspecies. There's articles that argue for four, articles that argue for eight. And I mean, really, all in all, it's splitting hairs, but it is fascinating in its own way, just to know which of them it is. The unfortunate thing is, the more, this is going to sound depressing, and I said I'd veer away from this, and I will, the more subspecies that we have, the more subspecies we actually end up declaring extinct, like the Western black rhino. It's something that I've always, black rhino are one of my favorite creatures in the world. They're completely nuts. They really are. They're loopy. They do the strangest, strangest things. Obviously, the scariest charge I've ever had in my life on foot was a black rhino. Her name was Elizabeth, and she was gorgeous, but not very friendly. So she charged us and stopped about 6 feet away from us. And I measured the track, so that's not like a sort of I caught a big fish kind of a story that just gets exaggerated every time. It really was 2 meters away from us that she turned. And they can turn on a dime. Very, very fast animals. You cannot outrun a rhino. But they are lovely. They love lovely to walk if you get it right, especially white rhino. They're quite placid. I've sat cross-legged for 20 minutes with a rhinoceros called Belega in an undisclosed time at an undisclosed location, watched her suckle her calf for 20 minutes. We sat there probably about 60 or so feet away from her. and she was completely relaxed with us. Again, white rhino is probably the creature that people underestimate the most. They assume they are very placid animals. They get habituated to people quite quickly on foot, until they don't. We had one very interesting sighting where we went out on a walk as all of us as guides, and we ended up sitting on a massive fallen knobthorn tree, watching the dynamics of the various rhino play out. And that comes into the family structures and the bonds between them. I'll tell you an interesting story about two white rhino siblings. And if I hadn't seen it with my own eyes, I promise you, I probably wouldn't have believed it. I would have thought that somebody was making this up, but I promise you it happened. It was two rhino called Chanjana and Ilanga. Their mother was my favorite rhino, whose name was Notches, but that's a separate story. So Ilanga had just been kicked out by her mom because her mom had just had a calf, and she went off and she found her older brother Chanjana, and she spent a lot of time with him, ultimately actually falling pregnant by him, unfortunately, but that does happen. Interbreeding with animals does occur. So Chanjana was getting to about 7-8 years old, starting to show signs of dominance. And the one day we came out on a drive and we found Ilanga wrapped in a strand of copper wire. Where it came from, we don't know. It must have fallen off a construction vehicle, something like that. But she was wrapped all the way around her back legs. It had wrapped around here. It went up her body and then around her horn. So obviously we had to intervene. We had to get a vet out in a helicopter and catch them and dart them. So we darted her. She went down. Chanjana ran off, and that we thought was the end of it. Everybody piled out of the vehicle because you've got to rush with a rhino darting. All dartings actually are usually quite a time sensitive issue, where you don't want that animal to be injured. The next thing, this helicopter came zooming round and buzzed low over us. We thought it was buzzing us. I looked up and Chanjana was running full tilt at us. We'd all gathered round his fallen sister. He obviously decided that this was absolutely not on. This is his sister. It's his all potential mate. You know, she might have been coming into estrus. Either way, he was excessively protective, and he came charging towards us. Luckily, the helicopter pilot had seen it and buzzed him away. But it was a very interesting insight into sibling bonds. I then saw Chanjana fighting one of the dominant males. And when rhino bulls fight, it can go on for weeks. Weeks and weeks, and they'll spend most of the time making that bizarre noise that you heard earlier, squealing at each other, posturing, and then all of a sudden coming together in frantic blows and then separating again. And they can do themselves quite serious injury. And she stepped, not once, but three times in that sighting, she stepped in between her brother and the other male. I don't know why. I promise you it happened. I've got it on video somewhere. Absolutely no idea why she did it. I don't know if it was to do with her being an estrus, her instincts. I don't know what it was, but it was an interesting sighting that she stepped in between her brother and a rival male. A rhino have really, truly fascinating dynamics. I'm not sure if I've lost Rebecca or if she's still there. There she is. Found her. Now, Genevieve, you want to know if rhino have an alliance with any other species? Oxpeckers. Just like buffalo and giraffe and all of the other antelope species, the larger antelope species. Rhino get these massive, massive ticks on them, particularly around the sensitive areas of their skin. So oxpeckers will gather around them. Other than that, not really. You'll see them together with other animals. Sometimes they're quite tolerant, sometimes they're not. I've seen rhino calves chasing impala for fun. But you'll see them sort of gathered. They don't really bother too much about the other species. I can't think of any other relationship that they have really apart from with each other. It's quite common to see white rhino and black rhino gathered around the same waterhole. And for the most part, they tolerate each other. Sometimes you get a grumpy white rhino bull that might go and cause trouble with them. But for the most part, they really don't bother each other at all. That's the fascinating thing about them. Completely separate. Yes, absolutely, Dave. Rhino and elephants do get into confrontations. It actually does happen relatively regularly. A famous story, of course, was the Pilansberg, where they brought in a group of traumatized elephants. And when the traumatized young bulls reached sexual maturity, they don't know whether it was an aggression thing or if it was to do with the bulls becoming sexually mature and just not behaving in a very odd way, but they killed quite a few rhino. That behavior was only stopped when they brought in a big bull elephant to come and teach the youngsters how to behave. And that's when they started to calm down, and it just relaxed their testosterone levels because it created a more natural environment for them. Rhino have been known to kill other animals as well. That famous picture of the rhino pulling the zebra foal out of the mud, that rhino's horn went straight through that zebra foal, and the zebra foal died. And it wasn't because it was trying, I don't think it was because it was trying to save its life, I think it was because it was trying to move it out of its mud so that it could go and wallow there. So it does happen, they have been known to encounter elephants, and they have been known to be killed by them. It's quite a rare situation. Fortunately for us, we don't have a rare situation in that we get to see leopards all the time, but of course our favourites are the royals. Let's go and see them wandering on the road. I really was very unprepared for this. I should have brought my hard drive. I've got lots and lots of rhino pictures on there. But of course, I didn't think that far ahead at 4 o'clock this morning, which is a bit ridiculous. But anyway, I've been looking at pictures of the various rhino species in the world. There are, of course, 5 different rhino species, 3 in Asia and 2 in Africa. And we've discussed a lot about the 2 in Africa. We've touched on. They're such complex animals that we actually haven't even really touched the scrape, the So there. Scrape the surface of rhino behavior. Now, just in terms of numbers, just to give you a rough idea, the white rhino is probably the most numerous rhino in the world, at round about 20,000, give or take. It's difficult to know exact numbers with rhinoceros or any animal out here. You never get an exact accurate population by doing censuses. There's all sorts of hidden rhino. There's some that may have been poached that haven't been reported. So it's difficult, but it's somewhere around 20 or so thousand. Black rhino is sitting just over 5,000 if we're lucky, optimistically. And you've got the greater, let me find him for you, the greater one-horned rhino, one of the ones that I dream of seeing. I have never seen any of the 3 Asian species of rhino, and I dream of seeing them. So there we go. There is a greater one-horned rhino and its calf. Plated. They've got proper, they look like little tanks, don't they? Like they've got armor plating around them. Oh. So that is the greater one-horned rhino, round about 3,500, give or take again, in the sort of around India, in those regions that you find them. That, of course, is where they are most protected. So even more critically endangered than our black rhinoceros. Then we've got the Javan rhino, which is the most endangered rhino in the world, Javan or lesser one-horned rhino. Google doesn't know the difference, which is quite distressing. I tried to Google Javan, and I could not find, every picture that came up was a greater one-horned rhino, which is distressing. There are probably less than 60 left in the world. I think the only remaining, if I remember off the top of my head, the only remaining population, I think, is in Indonesia. I know they were declared extinct in Vietnam in 2010, obviously, since that is one of the areas where the greatest use of rhino horn as a medicinal product comes from. So here we go. There is a really lovely picture, a beautiful picture of a Javan rhino, lesser one-horned. You can see it's also armor plated. You can see the connection there with the greater one-horned, just in terms of its evolutionary background. But really, that is not the best picture in the world. It looks as though it's come from the early 20th century. It probably did. Well, I suppose that was back when they had rhino to take picture of. Trying to find less than 60 rhino to actually photograph might prove to be quite tricky. And then my dream of seeing this particular rhino, just because they're fluffy, and I love the idea of fluffy rhino, Sumatran rhino, almost as endangered as the lesser one-horned rhino. Aren't they cute? Look at all the fluffiness around it. The hairiest rhino species, probably around 100, possibly less than 100 species left in this particular area. There you go. And those are our rhinoceros. Let's just do, for completeness sake, let us do our black rhino. See the sexy curve to its back? I love that. That one's obviously chipped off the front of its horn. That happens naturally. It's split ever so slightly. And it's like having a fingernail or a toenail that's split, because again, that is essentially what rhino horn is. Fingernails, keratin, it's like your hair. It's very compact hair. Seems to make total sense. You might as well go and bite your nails for all the good that it's going to do you medicinally. Hooked lip and long secondary horn. I love them. They really, truly are fascinating creatures. Quite a short head and round ears. You can see that slightly upright posture to its head. That's also why they've earned a reputation for being grouchy, because they look at you with their heads up, whereas white rhino often look at you with their heads down. And then lastly, just to complete our list of 5, Sorry, Ryan. Here we go. There is our white rhinoceros, the largest, in answer to Umkar's question, the largest of our rhinoceros species, tipping the scales at over 2 tons. The smallest rhino, Umkar, I'm actually not sure. I'm not sure which one of them competes. I know that black rhino and lesser one-horned rhino are pretty much on the same scale in terms of size. They're probably among some of the smallest. I don't think you're going to... A black rhino cow probably sits at around 800 kilograms, so just over 1,000, just close to 1,700 pounds, give or take. So that's quite tiny. That's probably one of the smallest species of rhino. I'm not sure which one exactly has the record for being the smallest of all of them. It's interesting. It's a good question. Now, Alexis, you want to know what the size difference is between the fully grown males and the fully grown females. Less than you might think with our African rhino species, bearing in mind that they can live for up to 40 years and they continue to grow throughout that period, you get some really large white rhino cows. I've seen quite a few that are basically almost at the point of looking like bulls, just in terms of their size. There's no difference in size between the rhino's horns. So you do get cows. They might be a little bit thinner, but you do get cows with absolutely massive horns. The size difference in terms of bulk is probably a couple of hundred kilograms. So a white rhino cow sits at around, they can get up to 2 tons, but probably just about under, whereas a really big rhino bull, white rhino bull, will tip the scales at 2,300 or so kilograms. So there's a couple of hundred kilograms difference between the two. And it's quite tricky to actually tell the difference between the two, but we'll go into that a bit later. Let's go over to Tristan, who did have a very close view of a leopard. I have to say, those cubs have been keeping me thoroughly entertained. I shared the exact same thought with Tristan when Hosanna went into that tree and it was bending. I was just imagining him sort of flying shot-putted into the marula tree with his mother and his sister. Fortunately, that didn't happen, but I have to say, I wouldn't put it past Hosanna. He does some odd things sometimes. Right, so we've talked a lot about now, we've discussed the various species of rhino. Thank you to all of you who sent through that the Sumatran is the smallest rhino species. I did know that. It was very dim of me. I remember doing a project when I was 8 years old, having just come back from the rhino camp, where I was, gasp, shocked, horror, allowed to break the age restriction rule, and we went walking through the bush, and that was it. That was me done. That was this was always going to be where I was going to go, and I got to feed a black rhino called Bwana and feel his tongue at their sanctuary. That was a very, very long time ago. My brother was still, I think he'd just been born, actually. I remember that was the very first trip we ever took with him. Anyway, moving on from that, now, the trick is now, how do we tell the difference between a male and a female rhino? If they have very similar sizes, if they grow throughout their lives, it can actually be quite a tricky thing. Because like elephants and hippopotamus, their testicles are internal. So their testicles sit up just sort of around their kidneys or just behind their kidneys. So it can be quite tricky unless you get a back view, and that, hence the pen in hand. Although I have to confess, I'm not entirely sure how I'm going to manage this. I've obviously moved my easel, my drawing board, not my easel, inside, because it keeps blowing off if I leave it outside. That's not working at all. Let's try. So unlike elephants, where you have the, goodness gracious, that's a rhino's foot, and that's a rhino's leg, and that's the bit where it meets under the tail. And that is a female. And if she is lactating, there we go, isn't that a lovely rhino bottom, Brian? I should have made you draw that. That is disastrous, and there's a tail over there. Okay, but it's quite a long tail, but it's obviously going to obscure the important bits that I need to draw. Unlike elephants, their nipples are between their back legs. So if she is lactating, you might see that. But otherwise, it's pretty much a smooth archway between her back legs. Whereas with male rhino, goodness gracious, that's a terrible rhino leg. Okay, just pretend that makes sense. With male rhino, you get, oh, that's shocking. You get a little V in between his back legs. That's, of course, his penis sheath that hides behind there. So there you go. That is really only, apart from if you see a calf suckling, that's really the only way. Boy. Girl. There you go. That's actually really the only way that you can sex a rhino, especially when they're younger. So it's quite tricky when you can't judge by their behavior. You know, if you are new to looking at rhinos, that is probably the best way to do it. That is terrible. Sierra, you want to know if I've ever seen a rhino being born? I haven't. Somewhat distressingly, I'm quite sad about that fact. I have never seen a rhino being born. I have seen a rhino a few hours old, though. Much like that baby elephant, it was a very similar sighting. Magic, magic moment with this little thing stumbling around. And it was actually quite a shame. It was quite sad because the female had just had her calf, but she had a three-year-old son. And poor Bakiri was so upset with life. He kept trying to go to his mother, and then she would fiercely and aggressively charge him and push him away. And he was so confused, he didn't know what he'd done. And Bakiri was always quite a bolshy little rhino. He did all sorts of very sweet things when he was younger. And all of a sudden, his behavior changed completely. All of a sudden, he was a lost little boy alone in the world and ended up finding his place with Robin. His older brother. And that little baby rhino then went on, the one that was born, he was also a little boy. Belega had an amazing ability to produce male calves. He was also a little boy. He would come right up to the tracker seat of the vehicles and put his lip on the top and sort of lip the tracker seat. It was absolutely hilarious. Also saw him eating grass far too young. They only really start to eat grass at around 6 or so months of age. But just imitating mum and then spitting it out again. So he was absolutely adorable, that particular baby. We've had quite a number of different rhino. I've had a lot of rhino calf sightings. I've also never seen rhino mating, but I have heard it. I'm sure Brent has seen rhino mating. It feels as though it's something that he has seen. But that lasts for up to 45 minutes. So it's completely different to an elephant, where because they have to bear so much weight, it's a very perfunctory task that they go about, the way they go about mating. With rhino, it takes much, much longer. Cat, you want to know how much a baby rhino weighs? Around about 40 kilograms on average. So just over 80 pounds. Much, much less than a baby elephant, but around the same weight as the baby hippo that, for example, you saw at Chitwa Dam, or could potentially have seen at Chitwa Dam. I don't think Brent saw it this morning. But around about the same weight as a baby hippo. There was something else I was going to say to you about baby rhino. I've completely blanked out now. What on earth was it? I'm going to try and remember. That seems to be happening to me a lot this morning. I'm trying to remember what I was going to say about baby rhino. In the meantime, let's go across to snoozing baby leopards.
Well, this is...
We are encased. I wouldn't say we're warmly encased, are we, Brian? No, it's a bit chilly in here. I mean, at least we're dry, but, you know, at the end of it all, we could actually have done the bushwalk this morning. But with all of this wind, this funny weather, we just didn't quite trust it enough to go out on foot. And especially with this much wind, it would have been a little bit dangerous to go wandering through when the bush is so thick. So, well, we wouldn't have had the opportunity to spend an entire 3 hours talking about rhino. On to the next topic. James, you wanted to know how you identify individuals, because I've spoken a lot about individuals. So how do you identify them? With a wild rhino that has been untouched by human interference, you start to look at, they build up natural, a lot of them have natural notches in their ears, like elephants. So little funny bell shapes and all sorts of little funny, there was one with a tennis racket shape on the reserve that I used to work at. So there's different notches in their ears. And then the alternative is to look, if you've got a rhino with clean ears, the other thing is to look at their horns, because their horns grow with sort of natural bumps and lumps and all sorts of things. And you'll find that there are distinctive marks, possibly where the horn is broken. Sometimes they split completely, as you saw in the picture with that black rhino. So there's the horns can also be quite easily identifiable. But the problem with that is that changes, because that horn is constantly growing. That's why a lot of reserves and a lot of places actually dehorn their rhino in order to reduce the risk. And we'll chat a bit about that in a little bit. There is an alternative system, and you'll find it's quite common in closed systems, in smaller reserves, or where rhino are being intensively studied, and that is to notch their ears. And what I've done is I've drawn a chart that I remember from the days of looking at rhino ears a lot. The only thing I can't remember is what number is allocated to the circle notches in the middle. I cannot remember what those were. So when a rhino is darted, perhaps to have a transmitter fitted or perhaps to transport it into an area, they will be notched. And they will be notched in different ways. So obviously one rhino, unless it is very unlucky, will not have all of these notches. So let's say it has a number 10 notch. And by the way, the values are essentially the same, just times by 10 on the right ear of the rhino, which is left to us looking at it. So let's say it has a number 10 and a number 7. There we go. Then that rhino would be given a name, or else alternatively a number 17. I cannot remember the circle numbers. I have a feeling it's 100 and 200, but I just cannot remember accurately. And then let's say we get one that's actually got a 70 notch and a 2 and a 1. So you'd get it with a name and the number 73. So that each one is allocated. And in that way, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, what is that? You get, haven't been a long time since I've done stats, you get a 10 to the exclamation mark number of possibilities. Is that right? Something like that. It's been a long time since I've had to do something like that with stats. So that is how you go about identifying individual rhinos that have been notched. Most ridiculous combination is 22, because then it's just two little notches out of the tops of its ears. It doesn't do them any harm, provided it's done with obviously the right antibacterial mixture and spray, then it doesn't hurt them at all. Now, Logan 10 and Charlotte 6, you want to know if our rhino have individual names. No, not here. They don't here, unless there's some researchers. There might be researchers working in the greater Kruger area that have named individual rhino. That's entirely possible. However, none of the rhino here are named officially, as far as we know. Some of the guides might have regular rhino visitors. They might have given them nicknames. But the rhino names that I'm talking about come from a reserve somewhere else. And I've worked on a few in this area with named rhino, because they closed systems. And they were allocated numbers and names just because it's so much easier to explain to somebody, okay, this individual, rather than WR7. White Rhino 7, White Rhino 10, and so on. They all had numbers as well, and it connected to their notch numbers, but it was just a way of keeping track, a much easier way of keeping track and drawing up family trees. Because, of course, as soon as you fence off a system, first of all, you're responsible for protecting them, and second of all, you're responsible for trying to ensure that you don't get any kind of inbreeding, that you try and strike the right balance with males and females. For example, sometimes you get odd characters. There was a rhino called Quasimodo, or Quasi, and Quasi had to be removed from the reserve because he was so aggressive when a female was in estrus that he actually ended up sometimes killing them by mistake. Because female rhinos, to use a popular expression, because I'm so in with the cool kids, they give the males bat. I don't know if that is a South African expression. Brian, is it South African to give somebody bat? I'm not sure. They give the males bat for about 2 weeks when they come into estrus. So the male follows along, and all of a sudden the female turns around and charges him, squealing, and sends him running away. And they do that just simply because it gives the bigger males a chance to come through and a better potential mate to actually arrive on the scene and to mate with the females, pass on their genetics. So there's a good 2 week period that they spend in the courtship. I'm sure you're all curious to know whether or not our leopard cubs have found a more comfortable position. Let's go and find out.
So everybody's still
camera, and that poor fish eagle looks so thoroughly miserable. That's sitting on the stump of the tree. Everybody's tucked up. I think we need a sort of a hot cup of tea when we get back, Brian. Or Milo.
Yeah.
Milo. I think Milo. Hot cup of Milo. Right, so we're almost at the end of our sunrise safari. We've got another 15 minutes or so. So for the last 15 minutes, we'll talk a little bit, because I said we weren't going to dwell too much on the whole rhino poaching thing, and we won't. We won't go into the atrocities that occur. But we will discuss some of the options, because I know some of you have been asking about them, and we'll lead into it with Brandon's question, which is, are there any natural predators to rhino? The only natural predator to them, really, apart from human beings, obviously, is a lion. A pride of lions can potentially take down a rhino calf, especially if you've got lots of them. They'll distract the mother sufficiently to try and get to the calf. I've seen it happen a few times. It's quite scary, actually. It's quite distressing to see because you've got this certain sort of tug of war happening to let things play out as they should naturally, and at the same time knowing that you've got an endangered species on the line. The same with the situation with the lion and the wild dogs. It's a completely natural behavior. It's been happening for a very long time, long before human beings came into this area. So let's just talk a little bit about the rhino and their horns. Brian, I can't sit still inside this tent anymore. Can we go outside for this discussion? How do we feel about that? It's better than, oh gosh, but it is so gloomy. Should we have a serious discussion with the bizarre figure of Tom Brady behind us? It's just, this looks ridiculous. I can't. Oh dear, Tom Brady's eyes are now leaking. Oh dear. Okay, we'll just leave that as it is. Ugh. Ew. Rotten marula juice. Poor Tom Brady. Right, so let's talk about various rhino poaching alternatives or sort of ways of combating it. A lot of you have been asking what it is you can do to help sort of urge people to avoid this sort of thing, how you can help in the way of protecting the rhinos. The only thing I can suggest is that educate yourself as much as possible about the situation, where all of that rhino horn's coming from. The fact that essentially that whole thing is run by enormous, enormous underground businesses, essentially syndicates that are involved in all sorts of wildlife trafficking, drug trafficking, human trafficking as well. So the money and the finances behind it is absolutely enormous. It doesn't mean it's an insurmountable problem. I strongly, firmly believe that we're not going to see the extinction of all rhinos. We might lose some subspecies, particularly some of the threatened black rhino subspecies. And of course, we spoke about the lesser horned or the Javan rhino being so, so under threat. But fingers crossed, we can actually do something about it. One option is to cut off the rhino's horn. But like with your fingernails, you can't cut it too short because it hurts the rhino. It will damage the plate beneath it. So they have blood vessels that sit on the top of their nose. They have living tissue that sits here, which means you've got to cut it about a hand span, and I've got small hands. It probably should be an adult man's hands. About a hand span above the nose. That's where you slice off the rhino horn. It doesn't do them any enormous damage. Yes, they do use their horns to fight each other, although ultimately by taking off their horns, as long as none of them have horns, then you don't run the risk of them actually injuring each other with one having a horn and one not having a horn. So you can do it in that way. But because rhino horn is worth twice its weight in gold, you probably, those rhino are still a target. So the fact that they have their horns removed does not mean that they are safe. I've seen 4 poached rhino that were dehorned in just the last 3 years. So it does happen. They just cut down below the surface of the skin because that rhino horn is still valuable to them. Dyeing and poisoning. 2 options that have been put forward. It's also a very tricky thing because with poisoning, obviously you've got to be so careful with the poison that they use, and they've put in a lot of intensive study into how you go about poisoning a rhino horn, because if that rhino dies naturally, something like a hyena or so on could come along and scavenge off that carcass, and then you've got a problem if you haven't carefully balanced what poison you're going to use. Poisoning and dyeing again. Dyeing helps you to sort of follow it. It makes it more obvious, but it doesn't actually taint the rhino horn in any way. It doesn't stop it from being used. And to be completely honest, neither does poisoning it. The chances of you actually affecting the sales all the way down the line to the people who are using the rhino horn is quite slim. But, you know, form your own opinion. I'm trying not to give too much in the way of opinion, just facts in terms of what we do. There's an argument for legalization. You can form your own opinion on that. I'm not going to touch on it too much, but the idea is to flood the market and to try and lower the price and therefore try and drop the demand for it. Make of it what you will. Those are the various options that you have. I was going to say, the other thing about poisoning rhino horn, you have to advertise that you poison them, otherwise it doesn't work. Same with dyeing, same with dehorning. I don't have rhinos with horns on my reserve. Therefore, you have rhino. Therefore, you advertise that you have rhino. It's not how poaching works, though, because it's almost always inside information that's come from people who already know the rhino are there. On that happy note, let's go and find out what's been attracting Karula's attention all morning.